Out beyond Land's End, the lone fishing boat runs before the gale, making for the shelter of Mousehole Harbour. Here, most of the fleet already lies safely in harbour, but the crew of the returning boat report that they have lost touch with the Mary Jane still at sea. The fishermen gather on the pier, anxious in case the missing boat should be in trouble. These are the men who would man the lifeboat should she be needed. Joining the group is Frank Blewitt, the coxswain. With Frank, the decision rests whether the lifeboat is to be launched. But first, he decides to telephone the Coast Guard lookout on the cliff top for any news of the Mary Jane. The missing boat hasn't yet been seen, so the order is given: man the lifeboat and stand by. Frank Blewitt and his men are ready to put to sea, but happily this time there is no necessity, for the Coast Guard has just seen the Mary Jane rolling home into sheltered water. Word is passed that the lifeboat will not be required. All's well. The last boat safely in harbour, the lifeboat crew return to their home. Yet even as Mousehole sleeps, lifeboat men will be on the alert, for they know that out there at sea, other ships and other seamen may be in danger. The following day, fine weather paints the picture. Yet even over so peaceful a scene as this, looms the war. Cornish girls are making different nets now, camouflage netting, while the men's work, fishing, assumes an even greater importance than in days of peace. But today, the lifeboatmen themselves will not be fishing, for it's a special occasion, a day of inspection. The inspector is greeted by Frank Blewitt. With no time lost, the sturdy vessel, the inspector aboard, is sent gliding down the slipway. Inspections and practices are held to make sure that nothing, the boat, the crew, their ability to handle her or to make contact with the men ashore, shows the slightest sign of rustiness. All must be in perfect condition. Nothing is left to chance. The efficiency of the lifeboat organization and the keenness of the volunteer crew sees to that. Known as the Penlee lifeboat, for she's kept at Penlee Point, She is driven by two 40-horsepower petrol engines at 8.5 knots. Virtually unsinkable, she is as efficient for her life-saving work as scientific ingenuity can ensure. After the practice, Frank and the inspector take a look at the hull and the propellers to see if everything's in order. But there's been a mishap. One of the propellers has lost half a blade. It may have struck a piece of driftwood or a submerged rock, but whatever the cause, it must be replaced at once. Elstree, London. Central depot for the whole RNLI organization. Here is kept, ready for instant dispatch to any of the coastal stations, every possible spare part that might be needed by any one of the boats. The men at Elstree are as ready for emergency as the men of Mousehole. Already, a new propeller is being prepared for dispatch to the west. Should a call for service be received by the Penley boat before the propeller arrives, another lifeboat in the vicinity would have to put to sea. But it's a matter of personal pride for the coxswain and crew that their boat should always be ready. At Mousehole, the arrival of the propeller is awaited with impatience. The coxswain knows the dirty weather may lead to a call for assistance at any moment. As luck would have it, it is now that the British tramp Matilda has her steering gear put out of action, begins to flounder about in a very high sea, and quickly becomes out of control. An S.O.S. is sent up. A ship in distress and his lifeboat not ready. This is the thought in Frank Blewitt's mind. The call has come. A ship in distress. Frank learns from the Coast Guard that the lifeboat is required immediately. He rings the mechanic to learn that the new propeller has arrived. The boat will be ready as soon as the crew. The rest is action. Propellers fixed, the men are ready, they're away. As the Penley lifeboat plows her way through the breakers, her radio receives instructions. The coxswain is given the message, and they battle their way toward the sinking merchantman. Meanwhile, ashore, the lookout is maintained, and news of the rescue is anxiously awaited.
Hello, Henley Lifeboat calling. Henley Lifeboat calling Land's End. We're alongside Matilda, position approximately 12 miles south-southwest Land's End. Very heavy sea, but we're getting our entire surviving crew. I'll repeat that. Alongside Matilda, 12 miles south-southwest Land's End. Getting off entire surviving crew. No extra help needed. Returning with all survivors aboard life. That's all now. Thanks for your help.
Not for the first time, Frank Blewitt and his crew have risked their lives to save the lives of others. And with the weather clear again, these lifeboat men return once more to their normal job of fishing. Beyond Land's End, a lone fishing boat runs before the gale, making for the shelter of Mousehole Harbour. Here, most of the fleet already lies safely in harbour, but the crew of the returning boat report that they have lost touch with the Mary Jane. Still at sea. The fishermen gather on the pier, anxious in case the missing boat should be in trouble.